प्रपन्नपारिजाताय तोत्रवेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः ओम डियर फ्रेंड्स वेलकम टू द स्टडी ऑफ गीता वी आर सीइंग द 16th चैप्टर दैट इज द दैवासुर संपद विभाग योग एंड वी वर सीइंग द सेकंड श्लोक यस्टरडे and I explained to you what is this daiva and asura. Deva and asura do not mean two groups of people who are fighting somewhere in the skies. Devas and asuras are our own human beings only. Our own good samskaras, they are the devas. Our own bad samskaras, they are the asuras. And usually this sort of clash in the mind, that is adhyatmika sangrama, that is an internal battle which takes place in the mind of a seeker, that adhyatmika sangrama. That sangrama is now being described, and Krishna is going to tell what are the things which have to be totally eschewed and what are the things to be cultivated, what are the bad samskaras which have to be totally eradicated or eschewed, and what are the good samskaras which have to be acquired. So now he is telling about the daivi sampath, this daivi sampath which is going to lead us to jnanam, that is atma jnanam, and that is the realization leading to moksha or liberation. So these are the things which we are seeing, and we are seeing the second shloka. Ahimsa satyam akrodhah tyagah shantir apaishunam daya bhuteshvaloluptvam mardavam hrir achapalam. So in this shloka there are 11 points which have been told by Krishna, and we discussed what is ahimsa satyam akrodhah tyagah. That word also we completed. Tyaga is because that word danam has already been said in the first shloka. Now this tyaga, it has to mean karma phala tyaga, that is ishwararpana buddhya karma, that is dedicating your actions to the Lord, or putting yourself in the shoes of the Lord, or working in accordance with the divine scheme, or aligning your will with the divine will. You use whatever phrase you want, that is what is karma phala tyaga. So that is tyagaha. Then the next word is shantihi, and then next is apaishunam. Shantihi apaishunam. Shanti, we know shanti is normally the normal meaning of shanti is peace. What is this peace? Peace of mind. Peace of mind again is a very strange thing. Peace of mind is something which you can't buy. It is something which you cannot buy. Many people may be extremely rich, but they may not be having peace of mind. Somebody may be an ordinary man, a very ordinary man. He is contented, and he is reading some books, and he is reading maybe some Ramayana or some other Bhagavatam or something like that, and he is in his own heaven. So that is peace of mind. An ordinary man, an ordinary beggar, he may do some hard work all through the day. Hard work means he may be begging here and there all through the day, but in the night he will have very nice sleep. Whereas a king, nowadays we don't have kings, a very rich man, a very big CEO, he may be taking some sleeping pills while going to sleep. So in spite of all that sleeping pills and all that, he may still have so much of tension. So we see there is a big chapter in the Bharatam, in Mahabharata, there is a big chapter where Dhritarashtra, that blind king, he doesn't get sleep. Dhritarashtra, we know that Dhritarashtra, he has allowed his sons, that is the Pandavas, to be expelled. Pandavas, they all went. They went out, and then they stayed for about 12 years in the jungle, and one more year in incognito, that is Ajnatavasa, that is incognito. And then they came back, and after coming back, now they are sending their, they are making efforts to seek their share of the kingdom. So that is the place. And this Dhritarashtra is not getting sleep. So that particular section is called Prajagara Parvam. Jagaranam, we know the word Jagaranam. We do the Shivaratri Jagaranam. Jagaranam is keeping awake. Prajagara means this Dhritarashtra is so mentally disturbed. That is, these Pandavas are coming, and then if the proper share, the kingdom, the share of the kingdom is not given, then they are going to naturally, they will fight. They will fight for it. Because it is what is due to them legally, they will fight for it. So this person, he is not getting sleep. So that is Prajagara Parva. Though in spite of being a king, and in spite of having so many advisors and all that, he is not sleeping. So at that time he summons that Vidura. Vidura is the wise minister. So he asks him, you tell me something, I am not getting sleep. Then Vidura gives him some harsh, not gives him, he does some hard talk on TV shows. You find a particular show called Hard Talk or Tough Talking. So if there is somebody, some big neta or some big leader is being interviewed or some celebrity is being interviewed, some tough questions, some very hard-hitting questions are put to them. So that sort of hard talk he does to Dhritarashtra. And then he tells, because you have done something wrong. You are not able to go to sleep because you have done something wrong. You have not discharged your duty. And you have driven away your own sons. Your own sons means Pandavas, who are as good as your own sons, your own younger brother's sons. So that is the reason why you are not getting sleep. Even now, if you want to have sleep, you do some justice. If you behave in a judicious way, you will get sleep. So that judicious conduct is what is going to give us sleep. So any amount of wealth may not give sleep. So the sleep is something, the shanti is something which is associated with our own conduct. Shanti is not something which comes through riches. It is something which is associated with our own conduct. And for example, there is an English saying also, uneasy lies the head that wears the crown. Uneasy lies the head that wears the crown. A person who is in a very high position, his head is always uneasy. An ordinary man may be having nice sleep, because the bigger a person is, the more likely there are chances of his committing some mistakes, being more greedy, being more avaricious, and in that process he is not getting sleep. So that internal peace is something which comes only when we try to examine our own self, when we try to examine what is the predicament of human being, what is this human situation. That is the adhyatmika, what we say adhyatmika. What is adhyatmika? Adhyatma is adhi plus atma is adhyatma. Something relating to adhyatma is adhyatmikam. Adhyatmikam is, what does it mean? It means something which is related to your own self. That is, we are supposed to investigate what is the human situation. If we investigate what is the human situation, human relations, and what is justice, and what is a human being's action, what is the expected action for a human being, right action for a human being, then we find some peace. So that is what we have to see in this word, shanti. Shanti is something which cannot be purchased. Shantihi. Then apaishunam. Apaishunam. Pishunata is the word. Pishunata is, that is, in English we say character assassination. You, in the absence of a person, you are discussing him. You are, at every word a reputation dies, says some poet. So you are discussing him, and then you are saying, okay, he is such a bad fellow, he is this, he is that, etc., etc. And sometimes you may be falsely telling also. Falsely also, that character assassination, there may be some truth in that. Even that need not be told. There is no need for some character assassination. And unless your duty is to report to the king. Suppose you are a spy, or you are somebody who is, your basic duty is to collect information, and you are supposed to report that information to the higher ups. So that is okay. But then this is something which is unnecessarily, where you have no role, where you have no business to do that. You are still doing that paishunam, that is pishunata. In Telugu, of course, we use this word in a totally different sense. Pishunata, we say paishunyam is miserliness, we say. But in Sanskrit, that is not the meaning. In Telugu, somehow, there is some semantic change. The meaning of that word has changed in Telugu. But the actual meaning is, paishunyam is, that is either carrying tales or doing some character assassination. So that is paishunyam. Apaishunam is not doing that. You are not saying anything bad about anybody. Even if you know, you just ignore it. And you are not supposed to speak, you are not supposed to do that character assassination. Tyaga shantihi apaishunam. Then daya. Daya is a very well-known word. Daya is compassion, where somebody in distress, we are supposed to show that compassion. If we are in a position to help, we are supposed to help. So that is what is daya. Daya bhuteshu. Daya bhuteshu, up to that point is one. Daya bhuteshu. Bhuteshu daya. That is, in all the beings, not only in the case of human beings, but in the case of all the beings, all living beings, some compassion, some kindness, maybe some giving food to animals. So all that thing comes under daya. Daya bhuteshu, then aloluptvam. Loluptvam is, that is, if there is some sort of tempting thing in front of us, and you immediately get tempted and go behind it, that is loluptvam. We say lolupa. Lolupa is somebody who is something looks like a lollipop. So lolupa is somebody who is just going behind something. He is getting tempted. Whenever there is some object, he is getting tempted by sense object. So aloluptvam is not getting tempted by various sense objects, various desires or sense objects. So one, a person who is not tempted by all such sense objects, that is aloluptvam. Daya bhuteshu aloluptvam. Then mardavam. Mardavam is gentleness, mrudutvam. Mardavam need not be taken as weakness. Mrudutvam, a person may be strong, a person may be gentle, but if it comes to action, a person may take very strong action also. One should be able to take strong action. That is also there. It is not as though a person should always be gentle. Gentleness does not mean weakness or meekness. Meekness is okay. Meekness is okay, but it is not weakness. A person may be gentle, but he has that mental strength. He has that mental strength to do the right thing. Suppose his duty is to do a thing. His duty is to do some right thing. So gentleness does not mean that, okay, he is dithering and he is feeling weak and then he is giving up his responsibility. Not like that. He is discharging his duty in a bold manner, but he is gentle. So mardavam, hrihi. Hri is that modesty, that sense of modesty. We'll just take a break and come to this word. Let us resume. We are seeing this word hrihi. So in one of these mantras, when you go to a temple, hrishyate lakshmishyapatnyau, there is a mantra. Hrishyate lakshmishyapatnyau. So hrihi and lakshmi, they are supposed to be the wives of Vishnu. So hri, what is that hri? Lakshmi, of course, we know. Lakshmi is that goddess of wealth, etc. Hri is that modesty. That modesty also is mentioned as that as the wife of that Vishnu. That is, hri is such a great quality. That modesty is something which is supposed to be a very great quality. Hri in one sense, that is, yesterday or day before, I explained to you, hriya deyam, shriya deyam, etc. Hrihi means that modesty, sense of modesty, when you are in the presence of elders, or when you are giving something also. We are not supposed to give in a very rash manner and in a disrespectful manner. We are supposed to give with some sense of modesty, with some sense of gentleness, and with a sense of rather shame that I am not able to give more than this. Not exactly shame, but some bashfulness, as we can say. So with that bashfulness, that is what is called hri. In fact, hri is also supposed to be, in Puranas, we come across this word also. Hri is one of the daughters of that Daksha Prajapati. We know that there is somebody called a Prajapati. Prajapati is somewhat like a creator, let us say. So he has got some daughters. All these Ashanti, Shri, Hri, etc., etc., they are all the daughters. And these daughters are given in marriage to some people. I don't exactly remember to whom they are given. To the moon, some daughters are given, and to Kashyapa Prajapati, some other daughters are given. So like that. So anyway, so this hri is again a desirable quality for a seeker, because the seeker is not supposed to strut about, and then he is not supposed to swagger. He is not supposed to have that swagger. He is not supposed to boastfully move. Then achapalam. Chapalam is something. Chapalyam does not mean, usually in Telugu we use this word, jihwa chapalyam. Chapalyam is always getting tempted to do something or to eat something or to enjoy something. Suppose I have got some chapalyam. Jihwa chapalyam is always trying to eat something. Or some other chapalyam, he is having some weakness for women, some weakness for this, weakness for that. So that is the sense in which we use in Telugu But the Sanskrit word is chapalyam is something different. Chapalyam is making some wasteful movements. Suppose we are sitting in a room, suppose you are somewhere not doing anything. Then even then, suppose some people will be shaking their legs, just totally shaking their legs. Or maybe moving about, making some wasteful gestures like this and this and then this and some various types of wasteful gestures. Or maybe just strutting about, moving about here and there. So wasteful movements are supposed to be avoided. Wasteful movements, they show that a man is not composed, a person is not properly composed. And even while speaking, even of course, when I am speaking, I am doing so many gestures. And some people, they don't do gestures also. They sit like this and then they do teach. Of course, that may be rather odd. And maybe doing some gestures may not be very, very bad and may not be very disturbing also. But I should not make too many gestures also. If I make too many gestures, then people will be watching my gestures and they may not be watching my words. So I should not make too many gestures also. So making some unnecessary gestures, that is what is chapalam. Achapalam means avoiding all these wasteful actions, wasteful movements, wasteful bodily movements. That is rihi achapalam. Then the next shloka, the third shloka, we are coming to this third shloka, and this third shloka we are going to get the verb. The 1, 2 and 3, all the three shlokas, they form one sentence, I told you. The third shloka is tejaha kshama dhrutishyaucham adroho natimanita. Tejas kshama dhrutishyaucham adroho natimanita bhavanti sampadam daivim abhijatasya bharata. So here also he is saying about six qualities. So up to second shloka he told 20 plus 6, about 26 qualities are being told as they are being classified as or labeled as the divine qualities. These are the divine attributes which a person has to consciously acquire. He has to practice over a period of time and then do acquire. Then tejaha. Tejas is, again, of course, some of these things, they come naturally, and some of these things in the association of people. You can't always study and acquire. Certain things, they are acquired in the company of people. For example, you are in the company of a hero. I am not talking about a film hero or somebody. Film heroes, they are not the ideal people to be emulated. A real life hero, let us say, a real life hero. You are in the company of a real life hero and you do imbibe some of these heroic qualities. So that we find, that is the greatness of the leadership. You see, the greatness of a leader is, he is influencing so many people. If you are a good leader, you are influencing so many people and then they do imbibe so many qualities from you. And that is the tejas. Tejas is, in English we can say that splendor or the sharpness. Splendor again is a vague word. Let us say it is called, it is a mixture of some sharpness, boldness and self-confidence. All these things put together is the tejas. A person may be strong. He may be having some internal strength. He may be having all that intellectual strength, but he may not be having tejas. Suppose a person is having a lot of intellectual strength, but he is somebody who is withdrawn, somebody who is, let us say, he is not outgoing, somebody who is something totally mild type. So that is mild type. We do use that word mild type. So here teja is something opposite. Tejas is somebody who is very sharp and then not aggressive also, not aggressive but assertive. Tejas is not aggressiveness or foolishly running or rushing about. That is a sharpness, confidence, boldness, not rashly moving or not rashly aggressive. So these are the qualities which are needed in a leader also. So for here also that tejas is needed. Tejas is, that is, you should have that confidence. You should have that confidence that, yes, I am going to achieve this. I am going to realize what I am. That even in this Atma Vichara, this Tejas also is needed. And this is one of the qualities in that Sattvaguna. Tejas in Sattvaguna does not mean dullness. Sometimes we do misunderstand. So the person is a highly Sattvika person, we say. Highly Sattvika person means totally mild and totally ineffective person. Good and good for nothing. Sometimes we say, oh, he is a good man, but also good for nothing. So, not like that. A good man and also very competent man. A good and competent, that is what is tejas. So, tejaha, kshama. Kshama is it can mean two meanings. Shama is, we do say, suppose you do something wrong and you seek forgiveness. That is shama. You have that ability to seek forgiveness, because many people, even if they do something wrong, they don't have that ability, they don't have that humility to go and seek forgiveness. So seeking forgiveness is again a great quality. Then shama also has another meaning. If somebody has hurt me, I am pardoning him. That is also shama. Somebody has hurt me, I have not done anything wrong, but still I am pardoning him. So there are two meanings in this shama. Shama is, one is seeking forgiveness and also forgiving somebody. That is shama. Then dhruti. Dhruti is, suppose you take a decision and you stand firmly to that decision. What is called a steadfastness. Steadfastness is, you have taken a decision and you are not vacillating. Not that vacillating type. Many people, they do vacillate. And in fact, they do not take a decision at all. And particularly, there is a saying in bureaucracy that if you are a good bureaucrat, you are not supposed to take a quick decision. You are supposed to toss the file here and there, and so many people, they write their opinion, and then suddenly you write something vague. So that is what that yes minister also says. So like that is dhruti is not like that. Dhruti is not vacillating. Take some sort of assertiveness, that boldness, and you are not, once you have taken a decision, you are not moving away from that fortitude, as you call it, steadfastness. Dhrutihi. Shaucham, this word also we have come across. Shaucham, shuchi. Shuchi is bahya bhyantara shuchihi. That is bahya shuchi and antara shuchi. Bahya means external. External shuchitvam comes when I wear some clean, not gaudy dress, but clean dress. So I should not be stinking, and I should wear properly washed clothes. And shaucham, even the body should not be... body should be kept pure, in the sense neat, clean, in that way. That is external shaucham. Internal shaucham is keeping my mind clean. Like the body is kept clean, my mind also should be kept clean. Suppose in my mind I harbor so many ill feelings, so many bad feelings, so many negative feelings against people, then my own shanti is disturbed. Yesterday we saw the word called shanti. Shanti is something, that internal peace which you cannot buy with money. It is something which an ordinary man may have, and a very, very rich man may not have. A very great CEO may not have, but an ordinary man has. So that is shanti. So this is, shaucham is something, that mental purity. So that mental purity, if mental purity is there, naturally you are more, that is what is shaucham. Then in fact, this shaucham also relates to the walk, that is speech, and also body, and also the mind. That is, the internal and external purity involves both body, mind, and also the speech. Even in the speech, that shaucham has to be there. And I am not supposed to use foul language, that shuchitvam. Shuchi in vak shuddhi, we say. Vak shuddhi is not merely the ability to speak fluently, but to the ability to speak in a proper manner. That is, not to use some foul, vulgar, distasteful words. So that is shaucham. Then adroha, shaucham adroho natimanita. Adroha, droha is, that is hatred, entertaining hatred, that is harboring hatred in my mind against somebody. That droha again is because of greed only. Suppose I want something, there is a desire in my mind, and that desire is not fulfilled. Maybe somebody has obstructed my desire, and that obstruction by somebody becomes the cause for hatred towards that person. So that hatred. So hatred means, if I am having some hatred, by implication, it means that I do have a desire. Suppose I am hating somebody. So by implication, it means that I do have some desire, and my desire is obstructed or disturbed by that other person. So I am harboring that hatred against that person. So that is hatred. So adroha is absence of that hatred. So that means you are in a very analyzing everything in a very dispassionate manner. So suppose you are not, if you are greedy, then naturally you will have hatred. If you are not greedy, you don't have any desire. If you don't have that desire, you do discharge your duty in a proper manner, and you be done with that. Discharge your duty in a proper manner and be done with that, and you need not hate the other person. So that is adroha. Then na atimanita. is again manita, mana. We have come across this word mana several times earlier. Mana, the word mana comes from the dhatu or the root word ma. Ma means to measure. The English word meter, matra, all these words, they are all cognate words. Mana, meter and metric and manam, these, again, all these things. Matra again is a Sanskrit word. These are all cognate words. So, manita is considering, yes, I am such a big man. I am so big. I am, and also I am comparing myself with the other people. That is, ma is to measure. I am measuring myself in comparison with the other person. That is manita. I am considering myself as, I am such a great man. Oh, he is such a useless person. So that is manita. Atimanita means a sort of megalomania. Not only manita, not only ordinary ego, but excessive ego is megalomania. So natimanita means one should not be a megalomaniac. It does not mean that you can have some ego. There is some permission for some ego. It doesn't mean that. Natimanita does not mean that you can have some ego. You should not have ego. So that is what is the point. Not considering oneself very great or not entertaining any such notions. He knows his abilities, but he is not boastful. Natimanita. So then Krishna says, here the points come to an end. Tejaha, Kshama, Dhrutihi, Shaucham, Adroho, Natimanita. 6 points have been told in this shloka. The second line says, Bhavanti Sampadam Daivim Abhijatasya Pandava Bharata. Hey Bharata, oh my dear Arjuna. Daivim Abhijatasya, Daivim Sampadam Abhijatasya Bhavanti. That is, all these qualities, they are with a person who is born in that divine dispensation. Earlier he told about Daivi Sampat and Asuri Sampat, that is the wealth, the divine wealth. A person who is endowed with the divine wealth and a person who is endowed with the demonic wealth. So, sampadam daivim abhijatasya. So, for somebody who is, let us say, who is born with the divine attributes. So, these are the divine attributes. These are the attributes or born with this divine potential. All these attributes, actually, they have got the potential to lead him to a higher goal. So, daivim sampadam abhijatasya bhavanti. Bhavanti means they do exist in such a person. Hey Bharata. So, here with these 26 qualities, Krishna completes the daivi sampat here. Of course, he told about this daivi sampat even earlier. But in this chapter, these 26 qualities have been listed out by him. So, now from now on, he is going to tell all the asuri qualities from shloka 4 onwards. We will see tomorrow. Harihi Om Tat Sat.